Okay. Good morning. I have the first session for today. Thank you very much. Okay. Today we're going to talk about KLCC versus Mount Kiara and how Iskandar Malaysia compares. My name is Ryan, and I am a Malaysian based in Singapore. My company is based in Singapore. I've been here for 7 years, and basically what we do is we do real estate research and we do events relating to real estate with a focus on Malaysia. And some Singapore. Okay, we do many events for developers, normally Malaysian developers in Singapore as well as in Malaysia. Some banks as well. Okay, today we're going to cover 5 topics. I only have 30 minutes, so I have to do it a bit concise. Okay, and first thing will be the Malaysian demographics. Okay, now I know today there's a lot of bad press about Malaysia. Okay, our prime minister is in trouble and. people, generally speaking, Malaysia is not a very popular place to be right now. But I just want to remind you that GDP growth in Malaysia is still relatively strong. Okay, we are doing 5% plus. Okay, in recent times. And one thing you may not have realized about the Malaysian economy is that we have just removed fuel subsidies because of the drop in oil prices. So the structure of the cost structure in the Malaysian government will get a lot better moving forward. Okay. Third thing is the GST. GST is an important revenue generator for the government. Okay. So although we may have lost money due to drop in oil prices, but there will be some sort of recovery because of GST collection. And GST, one thing if you notice, will create inflation, which is only good for real estate. Okay. Just want to remind another point. Fourth point is that we're doing a lot of affordable housing schemes because that's where the demand is today. Now, Malaysia, one thing is that we have hit 30 million population last year. Okay, so in case you're wondering how big the Malaysian population size is, this is the number, 30 million. Okay, and the other thing that you will see very clearly in Malaysia today is what we call the rural-urban migration. You go to small towns in Malaysia today, all are hollowing out. Population shrinking, only left old people. Okay, young people all moving to cities. And the cities are basically KL, Penang, and JB. Okay. The other thing is that Malaysian population is still very young. Okay, our 2012 median age is actually 28, 29 years of age. Okay, compared to Singapore, which is about 40. Okay, which means if you're above 40 years old in Singapore, you are old. Okay, under 40, you're considered young. That's how it works. So Malaysia, if you are under under 28, 29, you are young. Above 20, 29, you're old. So I'm actually old category considered in Malaysia. Okay, young means strong housing demand. Okay, so other point is a house price index. This is broken down by state. This is a Ho Chin Sun slide. And you can see that among all states, actually KL, Sabah is a bit of an aberration, but you can use KL as the so-called strongest in terms of house price growth. And the way to read it is basically if you see the figure, the growth rate, compounded annual growth rate here, okay, you can see that on average, KL has grown 6.5%, 6.52% over the 20-year period. So if you inflation rate, so to put it simply, KL property prices will go up 6.5% every year on average over a 20-year time frame. This is the statistics. Johor is the worst performer, only 3.18% over the 20-year time frame. But look at the 2014 rate, 10%. So 1 year alone jumped 10%. In Johor. So Johor has only recently seen a very, very strong revival. A lot of older Singaporeans say that Johor property market cannot make it. Because why? Why? Because they are referring to the 2000 to 2010 time frame, if you see. 2000-2010 frame, actually Johor property prices went negative. Lost money. So because proximity to Singapore, most Singaporeans buy in Johor and they lost money, so they say Malaysia property very bad. but actually, if you invest in other places or look at the broader speaking market, you could have made money, like for example in KL, 6.5% over a 10-year time frame. The problem with most Singapore buyers is that you don't know how to choose your options. There could be 10 projects for you to choose, you choose the wrong ones. And Singaporeans tend to choose the wrong ones. I'll be very honest, because you don't know what Malaysians want, okay? And you don't get access to all the broad range of properties available in Malaysia, okay? So what are the problems that face Klang Valley today, other than politics? Okay, basically, is the raising productivity and getting our middle income to high income. Malaysians are not poor, we are considered a middle income country. The problem that Malaysia has today is how to jump from middle income to high income, like Singapore. Okay, Singapore is a high-income country. And one of the problems that KL faces today is actually traffic congestion. We have now become something like Bangkok. Not as bad as Jakarta, but like Bangkok maybe 5 years ago. Okay, traffic is a big problem. Reduces productivity. We always have a joke that the boss will tell the staff, I cannot pay you higher salary if every day you get stuck 2 hours in the gym. Okay, real problem today. I you can try anyone who go drive in KL. KL traffic is getting worse and worse. And yes, a big impact, you know, you can see 1.5%, 2% of GDP is lost just because of traffic congestion. So which is why the government now is embarking on the MRT solution. Okay, so we are now have this many so-called train track or high-speed rail MRT projects in Klang Valley, quite a few. Okay, the first one, which I think most of you might be familiar, is the MRT1, which is scheduled to be ready, the first phase, sometime next year, earliest, or worst case will be early 2017. Very advanced stage of construction. Actually, the guy who is running the project is the guy that built our Northeast Line in Singapore. He's a Singaporean. So just to let you know, progressing very fast. MRT2 will now happen soon. It's already open for public feedback. This is our second MRT track. Okay, so public is already given their feedback. And so basically to summarize Klang Valley, okay, young population will drive growth in urban centers, KL, Penang, JB. And traffic problems, especially when we fix it in KL, will push productivity and incomes to the next level, which will of course happen over the next 5-10 years. Okay, if you're keen to find out more about KL MRT or the high-speed rail, we have books for sale. You can come over to my booth later at the end the corner over there. Okay, and find out more. Okay, the books are by Ho Chin Soon. It explains to you why high-speed rail will work, compare it to other cities in the world. Okay, and why MRT, how the MRT alignment is in KL. We also have free maps for those of you who want to find out more. Okay, KLCC. KLCC, basically, I think all of you are familiar what KLCC is, Kuala Lumpur City Centre. Border, we demarcate by these roads. Okay, landmarks, of course, include the Petronas Twin Towers. In Singapore perspective, it's like Raffles Place. Okay, Raffles Place, Marina Bay, this is what KLCC is to Kuala Lumpur. And if you go to, there's a map of it, you can get it from us. And these are the landmarks, okay, shopping malls and office towers within the CBD zone of KLCC. Now, if you look at real estate within KLCC, most expensive properties are, as per what you see there today, these are all penthouses, basically. Okay, so the most expensive property you can get in KLCC is about 5 million ringgit, and these are penthouse units. Okay, resale, this is not new launch. Resale properties, okay, transacted, okay, and the cheapest you can get, as you can see there, these are one bedroom units, Parkview, very near Jalan P. Ramli, okay, all the way to Menara Avenue, okay, the number of transactions, okay, as you can see there within the KLCC zone, plus the average per square foot. So you can see the average per square foot in KLCC are actually only about 1,000 only, okay. Just want to remind you, for those of you who are looking to buy KLCC property, the average resale transaction in KLCC is actually only about 1,000 per square foot ringgit. Okay, of course, these are older projects. Now, the other thing you have noticed is that price growth. Okay, so these are properties in KLCC that have grown very well in terms of per annum price growth over the past, since their TOP date. Okay, Hampshire Place, 10.5%. Gross yields based on asking yields. Okay, so asking yields 5% to 6%. Okay, but actually your net will be nearer to 4 after you minus expenses. Okay, nearer to 4%. This is top 10 high rise with highest indicative rental yield. Okay, now the other thing you might notice, Ryan, if KLCC resale transaction is 1,000 per square foot, how come some of the properties that they are selling today are so higher? 2,000, 3,000 per square foot. Because today we have something what we call branded versus non-branded property. Okay, branded, we are referring to properties that are usually tied up with a hotel. Singapore recently, we had the Residences, which is a tie-up with W Hotel. Okay, we also have Ritz-Carlton. There's also Conlay 8, which is a tie-up with a Russian hotel brand called Kempinski. Okay, so branded property with hotel, you see the price is one category. Non-branded KLCC property, the price is one more category. Okay, so actually a lot of you, if you buy KLCC, I just want to warn you that you must understand, in a way you are buying a trophy asset. A trophy asset. This is a trophy property. Okay, you are buying the brand, you are buying the Ritz-Carlton, you are buying the Four Seasons. Okay, that is what KLCC is about. Locals very rarely buy KLCC for rental or all these sort of things. Okay, because locals cannot stay there, they cannot afford. So when you, and most of the properties that come in Singapore, like KLCC properties, are actually trophy assets, not really rental grade property. They may appreciate price because of the quality of the asset, but they rarely appreciate because of rental yield. Okay, KLCC rental yields are actually probably among the lowest in KL. Okay, if you don't like KLCC, sometimes you will see substitutes like Bukit Bintang. Okay, Bukit Bintang is the Orchard Road, so to speak, of Kuala Lumpur. I'm sure many of you have been there where Pavilion is, okay, Sungai Wang, or Ampang Hile, which is the Embassy Road. So these are normally areas which are quite popular in Singapore. People come and market these products in Singapore to you. Okay, now that's KLCC. Now next place is Mount Kiara. Okay, Mount Kiara, northwest of KL, basically is an expat population area. In Singapore, we can compare it to River Valley. That means quite near to CBD, but not CBD. Okay, very high expat population. Okay, Mount Kiara originally is a rubber plantation. Okay, many years ago, it's all rubber trees, and transformed into by one developer called Sunrise. You go to Mount Kiara today, you will find very nice shopping malls, Publica, okay, Solaris. Okay, these are very, very nice shopping malls. I think if you guys go there, you enjoy it very much. Nice and not so crowded. Singapore shopping malls are very crowded, but these malls are just nice and very, very high end, very well maintained. Okay, and international schools, Garden, which is the most expensive international school in Malaysia, is over there, as well as MKA International. Okay, Mount Kiara, most expensive condos. Okay, by per square foot, you can see that goes all the way until 1,000. Okay, in fact, Pavilion Hilltop Mount Kiara also more than 1,000 per square foot, the new launch. But these are resale transactions. So you can see, generally speaking, 600 plus to 1,000 for the most expensive ones. The cheaper ones run as low as 400 to 500 plus per square foot ringgit in Mount Kiara. Okay, all this is in per square foot. Look at transactions, okay. Generally speaking, Mount Kiara on average now roughly 680, 700 there around. Now it's hit about 700. Mount Kiara average resale transactions. Okay. Top 10 by annual price growth. Okay. See, even Kiara 9, 23% per annum price growth. rents yields similar to KLCC, 4.5%, 6% gross. Your net again will be about 4% plus per annum. Okay, substitute. You may have heard of Bangsa. Bangsa is very near to Mount Kiara. It's the big difference Bangsa has is it has more landed properties. Okay, so something like Bukit Timah of sorts, okay, but similar profile. Hatamas, one thing about some real estate that you may have seen marketed in Singapore, they call it Mount Kiara, but actually it's Hatamas location. There are I don't know whether you notice this, okay. They have a name that very similar to Mount Kiara, but actually the property actually is sitting on Hatamas land. So very careful sometimes when you buy. Because Mount Kiara itself actually don't have very much land left. Okay, so some of these Hatamas developers, they try and pretend to be Mount Kiara developer. So they call their name very similar to Mount Kiara names. Okay, so be careful about these sort of things. Okay, Klang Valley, what are some of the big trends? There's a land grab. Okay, land in Malaysia now is, price is skyrocketing, okay? And these are some transactions of major land transactions in recent times, up to May this year, okay? Some of it involved the Singapore developers. You guys know Oxley Group? Oxley has land today in KL area. So is the Roxy Pacific. Mackley Group also has land in KL area. Royal Brothers, the, you know, the Hindustani, but what's it? I can't remember their names. The ones based in, they also have land. They bought a hotel actually in KL. Okay. And you can see land prices have shot up 3,000 plus per square foot on average, recent transactions. Okay. The record is actually about 7,003 per square foot in KL, in Bukit Bintang. okay, for land. Okay, so if you look at the KL thing, you know, KL is very popular. You know, in Singapore, is your land use is very efficient, right? You don't have abandoned plots or buildings which are underutilized. Okay, Singapore land use is very, very good. In KL, we are getting to that point. Now, a lot of abandoned buildings in KL are all being revived. We are tearing down old hotels, rebuilding into new office towers, etc. It's become, if you look at this map, this is a KLCC map. Everything in red, with a red color box, a circle, represents that either there's construction going on or there is a redevelopment plan currently being submitted. May not have been approved, being submitted. Either already under construction, which means already undergoing redevelopment, or there is a redevelopment plan in submission. It's massive, massive. So everybody in KL who owns a property in KL today want to upgrade the use of the land because they feel that it can do better. And you're getting higher and higher plot ratios in KLCC today, higher and higher. Now you want to get 12, you know, above 12 is quite common plot ratio application today in KL. Even DBKL is giving you such plot ratios today because they know that they want to increase density. Okay, so you can see it's massive the way land is being relooked in KLCC. Okay, now Iskandar. Okay, I noticed today that all the developers outside are from have Iskandar presence. So, now I know Iskandar today is not popular. That is because primarily the Singapore media has mentioned this type of statements, which is actually they're grossly very wrong. I explained to you why the Singapore media is wrong in that sense. Okay, this even came out in Parliament, right? Parliament, one minister said this statement. So it makes Singapore Johor look very, very bad. Okay. Now, number one, the figures quoted are actually for the whole Johor state. Okay, Johor is actually, you can see, the whole green colour state over there. Iskandar only represents the blue colour portion. So when when we say that 300 over 1,000 units in Johor upcoming, actually that's for the whole Johor. Iskandar only represents roughly two-thirds, which is about 200 plus 1,000. Okay, that's number one. Okay, point number one. Easy to understand. Next point. When we say incoming supply in Malaysia, the way it's defined in Malaysia versus Singapore is different. Different. Okay, Singapore, I give you an example on the left. Singapore, most of the land in Singapore come from government land sales, GLS. Government sell you the land, you have to build. Very likely you have to build. I mean, very rarely you buy land and you don't build, right? I think everybody have to build. And then nowadays you have things like ABSD. You don't, anything that you cannot sell after completion, you have after some time frame, you have to pay ABSD. Foreign developers got QC fees some more. So all developer buy land means have to build and sell one. Okay, in today's environment. Okay, so in that sense, when you want to predict incoming supply in Singapore, it's quite accurate. Very hard to go wrong one. It's 99% there one, right? It will not run very far. In Malaysia, land cost is a lot lower. Okay? Number one, you can buy land and you can sit on it, you don't build. Even though you got approval, DO, development order to build. Okay, normally DO in Malaysia in Johor is 2 year time frame. I get approval to build, you got 2 years to start construction. If you don't build in the 2 years, you have to apply one more time. DO, development order, in Malaysia. You don't build, you got DO, but don't build, will the government penalize you? No. No. There is no penalty. You just basically wasted your effort and time to go and get the DO. So in Malaysia, when they give you this incoming supply, actually they calculated all the units that got DO on. Whether the developer end of the day go and build is a different story. Understand? Understand? So I get a DO, I go out and market don't want to buy. I can only sell 10%. What do? I don't build. So in the sense, when we say 300,000 incoming supply in Malaysia, that 300,000 figure very flexible one. Okay? People don't buy, don't build. People buy, I build. This is a good thing of how the Malaysian system works. Okay? So don't get alarmed. 300,000 incoming figure, actual construction figure, much, much lower. Much, much lower. Okay? Why the DO figure is so high? Because a lot of developers tried their luck, want to see whether can sell or cannot sell. Recently, Iskandar was very popular, right? So all the developers got DO, come, let's go and see whether can sell or not. But they don't necessarily have to build. So the system is very different. So what happened if the land I buy? Never mind, land how much only? Land is how much compared to Singapore land? Okay. Somehow in Malaysia, it's very common to do what we call a joint venture. Party A owns the land, I'm the developer, party B. I go to party A, come, let's work together. You inject the land to the project, I build for you. We share the profits. How much do I pay for the land? Zero. I paid nothing. I only give shares to the landowner. And if you don't build, we get nothing. Understand? So there are a lot of projects out there, even in this Malaysian figure, 300,000, which are JV projects. So actually, the developer didn't pay for any land cost. His land cost is zero. In Singapore, can you do that? Technically, you can, but it's not very common. Okay, so Malaysian system and Singapore system are very different. So don't get alarmed. So when you say 300,000 incoming supply, build or don't build is a different story. Okay? Number three, there was some reference to make that the entire Malaysian Johor incoming supply is equivalent to the whole Singapore private housing supply. But you must make an apple-to-apple comparison where you compare public and private housing equal to Johor private housing, private plus public housing. Okay, sorry. Private plus public housing in Johor compared to private plus public housing in Singapore. You make the comparison and use the population ratio, you notice that the population ratio is actually quite similar, about 4 people per home in Johor versus Singapore. So similar. Okay, so there is no worse off than Singapore, same as Singapore in terms of number of houses. Okay, if you compare apple to apple. Okay, the problem is that the statement was made apple to orange. Okay, so if you compare apple to apple, total housing supply, you see that the figures are actually quite similar. Singapore also has a very extensive incoming housing supply. Actually, if you look the whole supply, including HDB supply, we have about 180,000 units. Is it? Yeah, 180,000 units until 2018. People always joke that Chinese developers in Iskandar like to do artist impression and show you 20,000-30,000 units. Correct? You don't like it, right? You think it's oversupply in when the Chinese developers come in. But this is a photo taken in HDB Hub of Punggol. Okay, I don't know what it looks like to you lah. It also looks to me like a lot of supply lah. Okay, so I don't know why it's very myopic. We blame Chinese developers for putting a lot of units, right? And then in Singapore, HDB is okay to do so in Punggol, right? Actually, it's the same. This plan is of course a very long plan, 20 years, 30 years, Punggol, right? I don't know how long it goes. It can go very, very long. Same thing Chinese developers. You assume that the Chinese developer will throw you 20,000 unit one shot. They won't. They're not stupid, right? They also will build according to the buyer demand, right? So you have to understand the context. Don't let the artist impression fool you. Okay, this is also artist impression, this picture. It's not going to happen one shot overnight. Transaction prices in Johor have shot up quite a fair bit. Okay, this is 2011. Okay, you can see that foreigners, as in Singaporeans, you can only buy property 1 million ringgit and above, correct? In Johor today. Those days is 500,000. At one point, it was even 250. Okay, so in 2011, I think it was, I can't remember, 250 or 500,000. But you can see that the number of transactions that foreigners can buy is only actually, if you look at this figure, probably 3% or lower. Okay, so total transactions in Johor, actually only 3% or lower are by so-called foreigners. Okay, that was in 2011. 2012, it has gone up to 5%. 2013, 10%. And in 2014, today, this is the first half, 17% of all transactions in Johor are 500,000 ringgit and above. Okay, and of course, not all of them are Singaporeans. A number of it will be Malaysians as well, those who earn high income. But just to show you that property prices in Johor have shot up quite a fair bit, yet the majority of transactions are not by Singaporeans, are by locals. A lot of locals are buying houses in Johor. Okay, I want to point out the fact. A lot of Malaysians, locals are buying houses in Johor. Of course, these transactions cannot be done by you, but you are not qualified. Okay, so the summary, if you look at Johor, is number one, it's not as bad as it looks. Okay, the media has given a lot of half statement, not completely true. Okay, so in a way, the public is misled because you read the statement and you assume it's correct. Actually, you don't understand the real underlying way it works. Okay, it's not as bad as you think. Number two is, construction system in Malaysia, very different from Singapore. You must understand this. Okay, so you cannot accept their figure. In Malay, we call bulat-bulat. No, cannot accept it wholly. There's a way to look at the number. is very different from the way you look at it in Singapore. Number three, a lot of homes that are being built in Johor today are for locals. That means Malaysians got money now, buy their own house. A lot of transactions, okay, and the house prices are going up. Okay, which means that population in Johor is growing. JB population was about 1.3 million back in 2010. That is the last census. 2015, unofficial numbers is about 1.7, 1.8 million people in JB. Okay, and so we are well on our way to the target, which is 3 million by 2025. Okay, and weakness, I like to call it weakness in Iskandar. Why Iskandar is weak today is because Singapore also weak. If you all feel that property prices in Singapore are going down, your rents are going down, I think that your appetite level to go and invest overseas also drop. Okay, if Singapore prices are falling, you also think that the Iskandar property price probably not worth as much, so your appetite to buy in Johor also drop. We must remember, end of the day, that Iskandar is very, very heavily influenced by Singapore. I like to call Iskandar an outer suburb of Singapore. So if Singapore prices are going down, it's not unusual for Iskandar price to go down as well. Okay, because we are all affected. There's 5.5 million people in Singapore, just next to Iskandar. So if the 5.5 million don't feel like buying, of course Iskandar will be affected. Okay. Johor is now net positive migration, more and more people growing into Johor today. This is to show you that Johor population is growing. We don't have the 2014 figure yet, but you can see job creation. This is a whole different story altogether, but it shows you that a lot of jobs are being created in Johor today. And the way to look at the property market is a glass half full, glass half empty situation. Okay, why I say that is because a glass half full scenario would be if we build all these homes in the next 5 years, okay, and we assume a very pathetic 30% occupancy rate, okay, we are still looking at a very, very large population growth into Iskandar. You get what I mean? You build 300,000 houses, cannot be 0% people stay, right? So if you assume 30% stay, okay, the population growth in Iskandar is tremendous. And this can only be good for the Iskandar overall economy. And I must remind you, majority of the homes being built in Iskandar are bought by locals, not by foreign buyer. Majority. Okay, which only means that population growth is happening. Okay. Long term, if you look at Singapore population, we are going to hit 6.9 million people by year 2030. Okay, a bit of math here. You assume a household size of 3.5, which is from Singapore statistics. You assume that only 10% of the Singapore household population buys one house in Iskandar. Okay, you can follow me. 6.9 million people by 2030. Okay, household size 3.5, that means divide by 3.5, each family. So I got 1.97 million families. Assume only 10% of these families. So out of every 10 of you in the room, only 1% believe me. The other 9 don't believe me. Say Ryan's talking nonsense. Okay, out of every 10 of you, only 1 of you believe me. Okay. So one of you believe me, I get 13,000 houses every year. Okay? If I don't use 10%, I use 5% because I have to factor in maybe the 6.9 million people, some of it is not qualified to buy one. Okay, I cut now and make it 5%. It's still 6,000 homes every year. Anyway, you cut the number, you can see that the potential demand is very high. The potential demand is very high. Okay, so even if Country Garden builds 20,000 or RNF builds 30,000, eventually all this supply can be absorbed. Okay, it's just a matter of time. Okay, and Singapore's aging population makes a lot of sense. I just met a retiree in Singapore yesterday. He just bought a condo, getting his keys. He's moving in soon. He's an ex-developer in Singapore. Okay, so he's going in to stay. Retiree group people, these are very, very, very encouraging, especially if ringgit stays 3 to 1 Singapore dollar, cost of living is wow. Okay, so those of you complain that CPF not enough, stay in Johor. Okay, that's an option for you. Right sizing here, this chart basically says that if you downgrade your HDB, you downgrade from a 4-room to 3-room or 5-room to 3-room HDB, the net cash proceeds you get, you can buy a property in Johor for cash or maybe 50% loan. You don't need so much loan. Okay, so very, very interesting. And this property you buy is freehold, can keep one, not like the HDB shorter lease version. Okay, you can give to your children. Okay, so Interesting, interesting. It's a very interesting option for the people, especially if you're 40 and above in Singapore. Okay, and again, Singapore age profile, right? Very, very supportive of Iskandar situation. Okay, I also believe that the older people in Singapore are the one that prefer to, that like Malaysia better than the younger one. The younger one doesn't understand Malaysia as well. Okay, so so the missing component is actually the train. Okay, once high-speed rail and RTS get started, okay, you will see interest in Iskandar return. Okay, the problem today is that we've been waiting for this for a while. You don't see any construction, so you get worried. Okay, but when it happens, which is just a matter of time, interest will return. Okay, and population will be driven to Iskandar. And last slide, I think it's my last slide. Pricing differential. Just to remind you that price difference in Singapore versus Iskandar is still very, very big. Still very, very big. Okay. This is in Singapore dollar per square foot. And if you want to find out more about Iskandar, you can get my book. I have about maybe 10 copies outside. Summary is, okay, these are slides taken from a property launch in KL. Okay, the queue, this is the queue. Can see the queue. Queue all the way until the, okay, until very, very far. It's a project in Cheras, mass market property, sell very well. So people say market no good, selected projects still sell very well. Okay, provided your offering is correct. This is another project that just launched yesterday. Where was this? This was, I can't remember, Exim. Okay, this is also more than 3,000 people show up over one weekend. Okay, not bad. So demographics are very conducive. Okay, young people want to buy, just whether they can afford and what property they want. Okay, we are the second most developed country in Southeast Asia. Singapore is number one, but we are number two. And once we fix the political problems, we will move to the next level. And Singapore Iskandar is correlated. Singapore do well, Iskandar do well. Singapore don't do well, Iskandar won't do well. Okay, no questions. This is my slide. Thank you very much.